That right tempo. Oh. Huh? Huh? Couple friends dropped by today. Probably never guess who they are in a million years. Never recognize their face or the songs. So I'd like to give you a little clue. One of them had a big hit on the song. It goes like this. I hear that train a-coming, rolling around the bend. I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. Stuck in Folsom Prison, time keeps dragging on. And that train keeps moving on down to San Antonio. Well, I bet there's rich folks eating in a fancy dining car. Probably drinking coffee, smoking big cigars. Well, I'm stuck in Folsom Prison. That's where I'll always be. And that train keeps moving, and that's what tortures me. Probably haven't guessed by now, so I'll give you another hint. Hi, I'm Johnny Cash. My other friend, big rockabilly hit, you may or may not recognize, so we'll give you a clue here. You ready, boys? Well, there's a one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, now go, cat, go. Don't you step on my blue suede shoe. You can do anything but lay off my blue suede shoe. And you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Do anything you want to do, honey, lay off my shoe. Step on blue suede shoe. And you can do anything, lay off my blue suede shoe. And you can do anything, lay off my blue suede shoe. You're probably stumped by now, so I'll just come right out and say we'll be right back with the great Johnny Cash and the great Carl Perkins. All right. One, two, three, four. Well, John, there's so many things to talk about, I don't even know where to begin.
Let's start.
Everybody knows that you started in Memphis. Mm-hmm. And trying to figure out how you got to Sam Phillips to catch your first records.
I'd gotten out of the Air Force in August 54. And I knew I was going to be in the music business. I always knew that for some reason. And Elvis was getting pretty hot not long after the middle of 54 on Sun Records. They got my attention like it got a lot of people's attention.
Mine too.
So I started calling Sam Phillips. I never could get him. So I had to go to work and make a living, you know, which is what a lot of us in the business have to do sometimes. Have to work. Actually work.
Still do.
So I had to go to work trying to sell appliances and home improvements. But I went half time to radio announcing school. I'd been down to the station in Mississippi trying to get a job as an announcer. I envisioned myself as a radio man. You know, I want to be a radio star. That was a thing then. And so he said, go to radio announcing school. So I went to Keegan School of Broadcasting in Memphis. And while I was there, I kept calling Sam Phillips, and he turned me down. I called once. I said, I'm John Cash. I'm a gospel singer. He said, we can't sell gospel music. So 2 weeks later, I called back. I said, I'm John Cash. I'm a country singer. He'd forgotten. Couldn't see me. So I called, kept calling until Sam finally said he'd listen. So I went down, and I sing, you know, just about every song I could think of for him. He finally settled down long enough to listen. And he asked me to come back in with my band. Well, my band was a Tennessee Two, Marshall Grant and Luther Perkins. So we went in, and the first thing we did, he turned on the recorder for the whole time I was there. And I recorded a song called Wide Open Road. and a song called Belshazzar, a spiritual I'd written. And then I recorded a song I wrote called Folsom Prison Blues, and one called Hey Porter. I'd written all four of those songs in Germany before I got out of the Air Force. And he wasn't really too high on any of them. He said, well, he's going to try to get Tennessee Ernie Ford to call it, record Folsom Prison Blues. Ernie was hot with 16 tons. Of course, you know, that didn't do too much for me. I wasn't really interested in getting anybody but me to record my songs. So he said, let's get a love song and release Hey Porter as the first record, which we did. And I wrote Cry, Cry, Cry in about 2 weeks and came in and we recorded it. And Cry, Cry, Cry put out as an A side, I guess. You know, back then we didn't try for albums.
They didn't exist back then.
No, really, album was something.
For a lot of artists.
Yeah, album was something I saw other guys in the Air Force have, you know, that they played jazz and all that stuff. every song, we didn't think about anything but a single, and it was 78 RPM, which is a pretty big piece of material. You know, you need a good song on both sides of it. So he went for both sides, Hey Porter and Cry, Cry, Cry. Both sides got played. The next one was Folsom Prison Blues, and by then I'd written So Doggone Lonesome.
I know when you came out, it was so unique. Your records had, with me, they had as strong an impact as the first time I heard Elvis, because it was so different. You know, I was brought up, I had a little band about that time, and mm-hmm. and we were locked into doing everything in meter and outright and tempo and come in here. And then you blew that all to pieces, because you had two pickers and break meter. You'd come mm-hmm. in late and mm-hmm. when you ought not to, and start when you shouldn't.
Mm-hmm.
Did you do that on purpose?
Did that on purpose, and also to wait till I found a place, you know. We'd kick off a song and then vamp till I felt like jumping in and singing it. Everything I recorded, the first three records, I vamped until I felt like now's the time. You know, one other thing that I did on I Walk the Line, I saw that song, I heard it as a real slow love ballad. And I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds, because you're mine. I walk the line. That's the way I heard that song. And we got in there with that beat Luther Perkins had on the guitar, and Sam Phillips had me put paper in the strings of my guitar, because I couldn't play it anyway. I used a piece of cardboard. They got a shuffling sound, and you're right about the vamp till ready. I didn't come in at any particular time, but we had a real kind of a gimmick sound there. As far as Sam was concerned.
Well, Sam was fooling.
Very natural for us.
Sam was fooling around with the tape echo and things mm-hmm. that nobody else was messing with.
Yeah.
And I could never figure out why. Why did you hum on I Walk the Line?
To get in pitch, get on pitch. So I sing on key, Bobby.
It was effective, I tell you. And
no, I just, you know, I had had that tune, I Walk the Line, the tune for 2 years. And I was with Carl Perkins one night in Gladewater, Texas, and I wrote the words to I Walk the Line backstage, and I used a tune that I'd had from the days of the Air Force, a tune that I had gotten off of my tape recorder from a guy playing the guitar, just making runs, chords on the guitar, and I played it backwards, and it had a humming sound to it. Mm-hmm. Guitar, just playing those runs, you know, sounds really weird played backwards. And that's where I got the feel for I Walk the Line.
And as far as tempo on your songs, you told me once, and I've never forgotten it, to arrive at a good tempo, it has to do with the heartbeat.
I was going to tell you, that's where I got the tempo for I Walk the Line. Sam wanted it fast, so I felt my pulse, and it was going, it was beating pretty good. Let me see if I can find it. Can't find it, Bobby. Yeah, there it is. Dum 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 dum. So I got the beat for I Walk the Line.
Well, that would be probably the most natural, familiar tempo to anybody living.
It's got
to
be. It's got to be, unless you're excited or on something.
Or on something.
Yeah.
When you moved to California, why did you decide to move from Tennessee to L.A.?
Well, you know, I wasn't really locked into Nashville. I was a rockabilly. And one of those guys with the sideburns and long hair from Memphis that really didn't quite fit in, although a lot of people in Nashville made me really feel welcome. But in 58, I felt like I belonged as much in California as I did in Nashville. And a lot of things were happening out there. I had a couple of offers for films that one of them worked out, but nobody ever heard of it. Thank God it was so bad. But I kept trying that. But I liked California. And I'm glad I served my time in California. I liked California. I lived in Encino, then I lived in Casita Springs up near Ventura for a long time. And a lot of good things happened to me in California.
That's where I first met you, in California.
I remember you were down in Hollywood. You couldn't drive or wouldn't drive, and you had had a different girl driving you everywhere you went
I didn't have a car, and everybody was kidding. And so nobody said, "Who's your date tonight, Bobby?" They always say, "Who's your ride?" But I came out to your house once for a goat roast you had out there. Mm-hmm. And I know it was the Carter family were there. Mm-hmm. Mama Mabel, Patsy Cline, Charlie Williams. And you're now writing songs that probably you've been writing gospel songs forever. Mm-hmm. But I just heard one a little earlier that you were going over. That's really a great song.
Thank you.
And why don't you sing a little bit of it?
Half a Mile a Day?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
I wrote this song and recorded it for Priority Records, which was CBS's gospel label, and they went out of business that week. So it didn't do too good, but I was kind of proud of it. This song is kind of a spiritual statement, you know? Like, people get up in church and testify and say, "Preacher, I'm going to heaven straight as I can go. I'm walking the straight and narrow." But I found out that I can't go that way. You got to go a half a mile a day and touch people as you go, and it's a struggle. But I am coming, Lord, for my heavenly reward. I'm on my way to you. Can't you see me coming through? Through clouds of persecution, and I'm stumbling all the way. And with my mistakes, I barely make a half a mile a day. But the road to heaven never had a rapid transit plan. It's one way with no changes, straight through to promised land. But I believe that if I heed the words he had to say, even I can get to heaven at a half a mile a day. Lord, when I let you lead, I don't make any speed. You have me stop and touch all the ones that need so much. And then sometimes I get tempted, and I fall along the way. And with my mistakes, I barely make a half a mile a day. But the road to heaven never had a rapid transit plan. It's one way with no changes, straight through to promised land. But I believe that if I heed the words he had to say, even I can get to heaven at a half a mile a day. Somebody say amen, brother.
Amen, brother. That's the way it's done, really. It's not done all at once, just a little piece at a time.
One piece at a time, that's a good idea for a song.
Yeah, it seemed like I heard that somewhere before. We're going to take a little break, and we'll come back and talk.
Okay, Bob.
So don't go away. John, what did it feel like when you were voted into the Hall of Fame?
Really exciting. That's a big one, Bobby. The Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
Yes, every country boy, especially if you ever picked a guitar, you know, that's been the ultimate dream. And I'm glad I could share it that day with my wife and my boy, John Carter, and my mother and my dad watched it, and that was the big one.
Well, you deserved it for so many different reasons. You know, you have influenced so many people's career, and you're a great human being, you know, without sounding mushy.
You've
helped so many people. You've helped, and you don't go around talking about it. You know, you don't say, hey, I did this for so-and-so. I mean, you helped me and Jeannie through some really hard times when our daughter passed away and everything. You were right there, and I really appreciate it more than you know.
Thank you.
Hell of a man.
Thank you, Bobby.
And out there where we live, you even have a parkway named after you, the Johnny Cash Parkway.
Yeah.
And your museum. What have you got in the museum?
Well, I got a lot of things from my career, my first guitar. I even got my high school report cards, and they'll show you why I did love music even back then, because instead of studying, I was writing songs. I got all kinds of guitars. I got Frederick Remington bronzes and antique one-of-a-kind Colt firearms. It is a real museum. I have Elizabethan furniture from 1640. June has Kirk silver from, you know, centuries ago. It's quite an interesting place.
I need to bring you something out there.
I'd love to have something of yours.
I'm gonna bring you the first car I ever bought. I only got it 3 weeks ago. You've entertained at the White House, I don't know how many times, how many presidents have you entertained at the White House? I know it was Jimmy Carter, and it was back to
Ford Reagan. Who was before that? Nixon.
Oh, I forgot about
him. Who was before that?
Whatever happened?
I don't know. I don't go back much farther than that. But I've known the last five.
At the beginning of the show, I was kind of kidding about you may not recognize friends that have dropped by. You are probably the most visible of any country entertainer that I've ever known.
I found that out at the Kmart.
You walk down those aisles at Kmart, a bunch of people come up to you and say, nah, you ain't Johnny Cash.
No, you're not. Yeah. They come up, or they come up like, I'm not trying to plug Kmart, but you know, back in the country, the first words we learned to say was mama, and daddy, and water, things like that. You know what the babies say, the first words they say, now they learn to say, attention Kmart shoppers.
That's right. Our little girl loves to go to Kmart. She always comes up with something. How old is John Carter Cash now?
John Carter was 14 March 3rd.
Boy,
he's almost as big as I am.
They grow up fast. Bobby Jr. graduates from high school this year.
Really?
The same little boy that stood on a stool and sang, Daddy, what if the sun stops shining?
How about that?
I heard you sing a song the other day that blew me away. And I had no idea that you had written it. And it's something about wings in the morning.
I wrote, you know, I was thinking of my genealogy back to 1667. I was thinking about my people, my grandfather especially. Grandfather Cash was a poor country preacher in Arkansas. And I wrote this song with him in mind, and with my daddy and mother in mind. My grandfather lived by the book all his life, on rich bottom land with 12 kids and a wife. He never saw TV nor rode a jet plane, but he knew that heaven was holding his claim. Wings in the morning and license to fly, straight to the portals of nevermore die. Nevermore pain in them old aching bones, wings in the morning to carry us home. Rocks in the road and we stumble and fall, Light's getting low, so we don't see at all. But I guarantee on that getting up day, wings in the morning and we'll fly away. Wings in the morning and license to fly, straight to the portals of nevermore die. Nevermore pain in them old aching bones, wings in the morning to carry us home. There's three verses, but I forgot the other one all of a sudden.
Song makes me feel good.
Thank you.
And then I guess that's the mark of a really good song.
It's got a promise in it, you know.
You know, of all the songs that you've written, and it may sound strange, but the one of your songs that I like best is the one that goes, I never got over those blue
eyes. I still miss someone.
Gee, that's a good song.
At my door the leaves are falling, a cold wild wind will come. Sweethearts walk by together, and I still miss someone. I go out on a party and look for a little fun, but I find a darkened corner, 'cause I still miss someone. No, I never got over those blue eyes. I see them everywhere. I miss those arms that held me when all the love was there. I wonder if she's sorry for leaving what we'd begun. There's someone for me somewhere, and I still miss someone. Now, how about
You know, John, you very well may be the last huge superstar personality with country music. You know, all over the world, when most anybody that thinks of country music, they immediately think of Johnny Cash.
Thank you.
And I travel all over the world.
Thank you, Bob.
And the music, you know, now is going into a thing where the artists are just another piece of a record. You know, they're technically right and everything, but they don't have that instant identity that everybody says, hey, that's a Johnny Cash. You know, it's kind of like, that's a good record, but who is it?
Well, that's nice of you. You know, when I really want to hear country music that I like, I listen to the top 40 stations in the middle of the road in Nashville, but when I want to hear real good country music, I'll pick out a little country town somewhere. It's a little 1,000-watt station, if I can get it, and to hear the good country music.
We're going to take a break, and then we'll be right back.
So all right.
Don't go away. There's much talent came out of Memphis in the 50s. Elvis, Jerry Lee Lewis, you, Warren Smith, Roy Orbison, Carl Perkins. And you introduced Carl Perkins many a night. He toured with your show for a long time. How long?
Oh, 8 or 9 years.
Well, he's out in the studio with the Pulley Bone. He's going to do one of his big rockabilly hits. So why don't you introduce the great Carl Perkins?
Here's an American original. When all the pop and rock stars want to cut a rockabilly album, which has been a big thing, especially in England, they always got a Carl Perkins song in there, somebody trying to play like Carl Perkins. Well, on Bobby Berry and Friends today, here's the one and only, the original Daddy Cat, Carl Perkins.
Yeah, I'm sitting here wondering about the box holding my clothes. Chilling, I am sitting here wondering about the box holding my clothes. I ain't got no match, Lord, I have a long way to go. Yeah, let me be your little dog till your big dog comes. Baby,
the big dog gets here, show him what the little Perkins done. Lord, I'm just sitting in the corner with the matchbox holding my clothes. Baby, I'm sitting here wondering what the matchbox holding my clothes. Yeah, I ain't got no match, but I got a long way to go. Come on, children, let's rock. Everything I do is wrong. That's why I'm sitting here wondering what the matchbox holds my clothes. Look out, children, I am sitting here wondering what the matchbox holds my clothes. Lord, I ain't got no match, got a long way to go. Come on, little guitar, let's rock on now.
Trying to get you on the show for a long time. We finally made it, buddy.
Bob, I have been watching this show for a long time and wishing I could be on it. It's a pleasure to be here. It really is.
You know, you got lots of fans out there. I know you influenced rock and roll more than anybody I know.
Oh, well, it was a way, Bob, that I found to get the cotton sack off my back. I was kind of mixed up. I wanted to be a guitar player and one of my uncles one Sunday said, that little boy can sing, Buck, talking to my daddy, and that got me confused. So I kind of combined guitar playing and singing and black and white music that I was hearing in Cotton Field and Grand Ole Opry, and it turned out to be rockabilly and then rock and roll.
Probably the biggest fans that you have were the Beatles. Still are, what's left of them.
Yeah.
Did they ever record Matchbox?
Yeah, they did. In 1964, Bob, I went over to a country that I know you've visited many times because you're very popular over there, over in England. I went over with a cat by the name of Chuck Berry. Remember
that
name?
Oh, yeah.
Chuck had never been to England, or neither had I. And I went over there. We did a 4 weeks tour. At the end of the tour, I was getting ready to come back to America the next day. The promoter of the tour said, Perkins, you've been invited to a party tonight. And I said, man, I don't want to go to no party. I got some dirty socks to pack. I got to go to America tomorrow. He said, you might ought to go to this one. I said, well, putting it like that, I'll go for a while. As it turned out, Bob, it was a party that the Beatles gave for me. And I walked in this castle-like place in the outskirts of London, and saw who I thought was Ringo Starr standing at the end of the table, and I said to the guy that took me to the party, I said, that looks like one of the Beatles. I'd never met them. At that time, they had never been to America. But their record of I Want to Hold Your Hand was red hot. And over here, he said, I got news for you. That is Ringo. So I must tell you, I got a little nervous when I saw out of the crowd came John, Paul, George, and Ringo, and everybody, you know, started cheering. And I wound up sitting on the floor, and the four Beatles on a couch, and I had an old guitar, and they were saying, hey, Carl, how'd you kick off right string with the wrong yo-yo? I said, where did you hear that? They said, we got all your old records. I didn't know it till that time. And then the next night, I stayed over and was in the Abbey Road Studios when they recorded Honey Don't, Matchbox, and Everybody's Trying to Be My Baby. I was sitting there watching them do it.
Well, I'll guarantee you, in the late 50s, when rockabilly was really coming on strong, that the Beatles, just like myself, you know, they would sit around and play those songs. I'd do Matchbox and Honey Don't.
Thank
and
you, man.
I know they were into you so much. Did George Harrison even change his name one time, didn't he?
You know, right after I came back from England, and of course I was walking around on a cloud there, little old home down in Jackson, Tennessee, and I had small children in school at that time. One of my oldest boy came home. He said, Daddy, you know them boys you recorded with, the Beatles? And he had a thick book that he'd borrowed from some cat in his classroom. I said, yeah, what about him, son? He said, well, that guitar player changed his name to Carl because he liked Carl Perkins. I said, well, who told you that, boy? He said, it's right here. And it's in a book called Beatles 65. And Paul has told me since then, and George himself, he said, yeah, I loved your playing, man. And back in those days, Bob, these boys were so brilliant. They had names for each other. You know, at one time, I think Lennon was called Fats, you know, because he was skinny, they called him. They were really a lot of wisdom, a lot of talent in them boys. I mean, they really were.
Well, you just recently did a sit down on a Paul McCartney session.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how did that come about?
Well, we go back to this little house down in Jackson, Tennessee. The phone rang one day. My little wife, Valda, who I've been married to 32 years now, said, Carl, it's for you. And he says it's Paul McCartney. I said, oh, it's somebody that moved away from Jackson and went up to Detroit, you know, the song he sang about, got him a job and got to drinking. He's going to call his buddies and say he knows Carl Perkins. I said, hello. He said, Carl. I said, is this Paul? He said, yes, it is. I said, what are you doing? I said, well, not too much, working a few dates now and then, you know. He said, I got a big favor to ask of you. And I said, well, let me have it. I'll be glad if I can do it, I will. He said, Stevie Wonder's gonna be there, Ringo, myself. He said, we're just gonna have a great time. Said, I wanna do an album. I'm doing it down in Montserrat, and I'd love for you to come and be on the album with us. I said, well, I'd love to do it. I got a problem. I don't know where's Montserrat. He said, it's in the West Indies. I said, well, keep talking. Where's the West Indies? He said, I'll tell you, I'll simplify it. I'll send you a plane ticket. No more than 3 days, plane ticket came to my home, and I left from Nashville, Tennessee, and flew to an island called Antigua, which is as far as the commercial airlines go. I was met by a little private plane, flown over to a little island called Montserrat, was met there with Paul and Linda McCartney, Ringo. I stayed 8 days down there. I played, this album was the number one album year before last. It's called Tug of War. Stevie Wonder and McCartney had a great hit out of that thing called Ebony and Ivory. You may remember
yeah.
that.
Great.
I was playing a little rhythm guitar on that song. Yeah.
My goodness.
Yeah, and it was a great thrill. It really was, Bob. Anytime any of these, like the Stray Cats or the people that mention my name today that are doing so well, you know, it's like I've been paid twice and a little bit too much. I'm very humbled by the fact that people remember, you know, especially artists remember what I did years ago.
Well, after you finished the album and were getting ready to go home, mm-hmm. you kind of wrote a song about
yeah.
The way you felt about your relationship with McCartney.
Yeah, I did.
And why don't you sing part of it? You even recorded it, didn't you?
Yeah. Well, let me see if old sticks in tune here. We'll just try a little of that.
How did you, tell us how you come to write it.
Well, As I said earlier, I'm touched by the fact that people like Paul McCartney and the artists of today remember the name Carl Perkins. And I remember very well, Bob, I was sitting out on the patio. It's a beautiful place, this island of Montserrat is, and I was sitting out there alone, trying to get pictured in my old mind exactly how I was going to describe it to Val and the kids when I got home, how pretty it really is, and how much of God you can see in that sky at night out there on that beautiful ocean. And I thought, in the morning, country boy, you're going to get choked up when you go to tell him goodbye, so you might ought to write the way you feel right now down, and which I did. And I'll do your version, of course, of it. On the Isle of Montserrat, no, I never shall forget, just a country boy, a guitar, and a song. You invited me in, and you treated me like kin. Son, you've given me a reason to go home. My old friend, thanks for inviting me in. My old friend, may this goodbye never mean the end. And if we never meet again, the sight of life in a little while over yonder where it's peace and quiet, my old friend, won't you think about me every now and then? And I'll think about you, my old friend.
Really great.
Thank you.
Paul McCartney, he played a lot of instruments on that record, too, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. I sang that song for him the next morning after I wrote it, and he said, Carl, that's a beautiful song. We ought to record it. So everybody that was there had already left the day before, and he played bass, he played drums, he played organ, played rhythm guitar, and I put a couple of guitar parts on it. He is singing a high tenor to the My Old Friend part. And I tell you, Bob, he made me a rough tape of it. Of course, it's worn out at home by now. But I heard from him a couple of weeks after he got back to London. He called me and he said, Carl, I've been listening to that song, and is it all right with you if I really do it the way it ought to be done? I want to put violins, I want to put voices, I want to really do it right. I want you to have a hit record. I said, good Lord's gonna love you for that, boy. Help yourself. And that's what he's done, and I've got it back. It's beautiful. It's gonna be in an album called My Old Friends, as well as Johnny Cash. I've already recorded with Willie Nelson, done two songs, and the Stray Cats done a couple. And this thing will be out here one of these days. And Perkins is going to rock again.
Lord have mercy, is the world ready for it? I'll tell you something the world is not ready for. We're going to do a commercial when we come back. We're going to get John Cash out here.
Right.
And the three of us are going to sit around and talk about the old days and all that.
Son, there's some stories to be told.
Nutsy things that we used to do. We'll be right back in just a little bit. Do you think is the craziest thing that y'all ever did on the road when you're touring together?
Well, I don't know, Carl. I didn't ever do anything really crazy.
I think really the thing that stands out in my mind, is one time John and my little brother Clayton went out just walking down the street, and for some unknown reason that we'll never know, they bought 100 chickens. And they got back on the elevator and were letting out little handfuls of chicken on each floor. And there were little baby chickens running all over that hotel. People was calling the desk. And they, one time they bought a...
We were good to them, though. We sent the bellman out for chicken feed.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And raised some of them. You catch some of them that get wing feathers on.
Took some of them home, yeah. Yeah. Six of them. Only six left after the end of the tour.
When did you first meet?
When was it, Carl?
Let's see, John. It was 55.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The best I remember, I think I'm right, I believe it was in the front office, which was the only office, at Sun Record Company.
Mm-hmm.
Because I remember John was real quiet. He had nice black hair. That's the first thing I noticed. I noticed hair even back in those days. And he was, we got talking, and come to find out, you know, he was raised like I was, a sharecropper, and only divided by the Mississippi River. I was raised in West Tennessee, and John over in Arkansas, and just, I just liked him. He was a quiet, real, sincere fellow, and that feeling never went away.
We worked our first show together right after that in Marion, Arkansas.
That's right, on a flatbed truck.
Mm-hmm. Conway, Arkansas. Conway Twitt is hometown. Hey, you know, Conway was on Sun Records, too. He's one
he
of the
was.
First.
He was Harold Jenkins on
Harold
Sun
Jenkins.
Records.
That's his real name, Harold Jenkins.
Yeah.
There's a lot of great talent on Sun Records. Do you think that Sam Phillips is just gifted with finding talent? There's so much talent right around that area.
I think he's a man of vision. He heard a lot of, you know, he didn't like the music that was ground out. One record after another in Nashville, he said they all sound the same. There'll be a fiddle, mm-hmm. steel guitar, and piano, and at least take a break, you know. And he just didn't like it anymore. And he told me that he found a bunch of guys like Elvis, Carl, Jerry, and myself that wanted to do it their way. And that's what he was looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Tell you what, that was definitely the big beginning of rock and roll, because Sam Phillips was the first guy that I know to inject energy onto a record.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we would listen, mm-hmm. we would listen to Red Foley, and Hank Williams had a certain amount of energy,
mm-hmm.
but Sam could take, like on John's records, mm-hmm. you had a two-piece band,
yeah,
and there's a lot of energy there.
Yes, sir.
He was the first guy to capture energy on record.
That's right.
What rock and roll is.
That's right.
Is energy on record.
You know, John, I'm sure you remember a mistake on a record, Bob didn't bother him that much. He'd say, but it had that energy. You know, you'd listen back and I'd say, but I made a mistake there, Mr. Phillips. My guitar wasn't right. He said, but that's just that one
feeling
little thing.
Right.
He said, everything else is there. He heard a click. He heard, as you say, energy in those songs by every artist individually, because nobody was copying anybody. Everybody had their own way of doing what they did. But he
made us project.
That's right.
You know, he made us project our feelings out onto that record, and that's what performing is. Carl's still that way. When he gets on stage, he projects right into their lap, and I do too. I don't know any other way to do it except just a ball of energy. Just pour out everything you got for as long as you can.
We're going to take a little break, and then we're going to come back and do something really special. We got it all figured out. Before I tell you what my big creative idea is for a finale, I'd like to say thank you for being here, Carl.
It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, Dandy. And John.
Thanks for asking.
Made this a real special show, buddy. Now, the idea I got, see what y'all think. Carl wrote a song called Daddy Sang Bass.
Mm-hmm.
John recorded it, and it was a big hit. So, John, you do the part that goes, Daddy Sing Bass.
Daddy Sing Bass.
And then, Carl,
right.
You do the mama part.
Mama Sing Tenor.
And then I'll jump in with the little brother. I'll be the little brother.
All right, do it.
All right.
Well, I remember when I was a lad, times were hard and things were bad. But there's a silver lining behind every cloud. Just poor people, that's all we were, trying to make a living out of black lander. And we'd get together in a family circle, singing loud.
Daddy. Daddy sing bass.
Then Mama sing tenor.
Me and little brother would join right in there.
Cause singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. Though the circle won't be broken, by and by, Lord, by and by.
Daddy sing bass.
And Mama sing tenor.
Me and little brother will join right in there.
In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
I remember, boys, after work, Mama would call in all of us. You could hear us singing for a country mile.
Country mile.
Now little brother's done gone home, but I'll rejoin him in a song. We're gonna sing again up yonder in a little bitty while.
Daddy sing bass.
And Mama sing tenor.
Me and little brother will join right in there.
Singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. No, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by.
Daddy sing bass.
And Mama sing tenor.
Me and little brother will join right in there.
In the sky, Lord, in the sky. In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
It's been fun, boys. Good night, everybody.
Thank you, Bob.